ಪ್ರತಿ ಸಲ ಕಷ್ಟ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ನಾರ್ಮಲಿ ನಾವು ಇವಾಗ ಎಡಬ್ಲ್ಯೂಎಸ್ ನೀವು ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ನೋಡಿದ್ರೆ
So I think license that should not be a problem. I mean, because we can continue it for 30 days without the thing. So, but if your laptop itself is having an issue, if it's hanging or something else, and then that could be, it should be corrected, because otherwise.
I'm thinking that it's not fully installed properly, because whilst I was installing it, you know, kind of crashed yesterday, but after I rebooted it, you know, it said that it. Installed. So I'm thinking that all the binary files are not installed, you know, are not in there, is my guess, but I could be wrong.
So if the problem is with Dell laptop, then maybe you can take it to the Dell service center to get.
Yeah, I've scheduled an appointment with the Dell guys tomorrow in the morning, so yeah. I'll take it to them in the morning. So what I wanted to say was, would there be quite a lot of stuff that, you know, we'll be doing hands-on, or today will it be like yesterday's class that you will show us all the commands, or would you ask us?
Yeah, not a problem. The session will be recorded, so we can continue this, and maybe if any issues are there, we are unable to follow any of the lab, maybe you can ping me in WhatsApp or in the chat. So maybe day after tomorrow, something like that, maybe we can spend some few hours to help you.
Okay.
Not a problem.
Okay. Okay, perfect. Yeah, sorry about that. But yeah, I'll try and follow as much as possible.
No worries. So let me out. I'll show you the, because there's another candidate also who will be installing this. So today I will be just showing you how to install a operating system, that is Linux operating system, on a VMware workstation. Okay. And then we have other lots of commands and labs which we will be following today. So good morning, good afternoon all. So okay, we'll start. So I already have a OS installed in it, so let's come to the starting point. So when you install, after installing Workstation 15 Pro, you will get a home screen like this. You can view my screen, right? So what we do here is that create a new virtual machine. Okay, so here for the lab purpose, we are creating a virtual machine, but in the live environment, you might be installing the OS on a physical system, or you might be installing OS on a VMware workstation, or sorry, not workstation. No, in the vCenter, right? I'm not talking about laptops and all this. I'm talking about real-time environment in the client situation where they have got a vCenter, or they might have got some other hypervisors like KVM or anything. So whatever the method is, okay, that is specific to that particular environment. We are not concerned about method here, because there will be different teams who will be basically doing that, correct? So basically there are provisioning teams who will be basically working on installing the OS, correct? There will be different teams in a real-time scenario, or in a company or in a client if you're working for. So there will be different teams for installing the OS. There will be different team for managing the networks. There will be different team for managing the storage, everything. So what you need to do or give them is that, hey, I need a VM, or I need 10 VMs. And these are the IPs, and these are the domain names or the host names. And I need a VM with so much of storage and so on, additional storage. By default, if it is a virtual machine, the clients would have some template already created. Okay, that means the virtual machine as a whole will be of maybe 20 GB or 50 GB or 100 GB, depending upon requirement. So those are all prerequisites or something which is specific to your working domain or working environment, right? So here, for the purpose of installation, I'm using a Workstation 15 Pro, which allows you to install multiple operating systems. Okay, so so here, when you want to start it, so we see that there is a create a new virtual machine. But if you're using in a physical system, so they have got something called, you need to get something as remote console. Like here, you got some console to work on. So there also, you have got some consoles like IMM for Lenovo systems, or you got ILO for HP systems, or DRAC for Dell systems. So So with which you, that system will not have an, that particular link will have an IP address with which you log in, and you will get consoles to work on that server. There is no OS installed there, but you get an environment to actually load an ISO and get a console, just like your computer screen when you connect it to a, exactly, correct, right? So those are all different methods of like getting into a console and then you start work. So here what we are looking is basically to get your OS installed on your workstation. I'm just showing you the basic prerequisite or basic prep work to start the OS installation, okay? To get the environment ready, not the OS installation, to get the environment ready. So here we are creating a new virtual machine. First you are creating a new virtual machine, right? So here what we do is that is a typical, when you click on new virtual machine, is a welcome to new virtual machine wizard. So it is a typical and there's a custom. Okay, typical is something like where you basically go ahead and install the operating system. You don't have to do anything. Everything will be taken care of. So we will do two installations. Maybe today one and maybe tomorrow one, or if we have some time later today, we will do that. So first we will do with typical and then we will do with custom. Okay. So we'll go ahead with next. So it says that key, how do you want to install it? So basically we are going to install using a DVD, sorry, my ISO, right? We don't have a DVD here where you insert CD and all that, which is taking a long time. So ISO is clear. So you would have downloaded the ISO. I have downloaded the ISO in my D folder, which I have browsed through. Okay, you just need to browse and there's the three files. You just need to check on rel server 7.7x86-DVD. Right, so this is the DVD, which is, you can see that the size is close to 4.3 GB. Correct, this is ISO which you want to select. Boot and the other thing is for different purpose, we'll look on later. So click it and open, so that means you are selecting it, so that this is selected, right? So it says that install a disk image. With this, so it has automatically detected, see, it has data Red Hat Enterprise Linux 7 64-bit detected, right? So with the ISO itself has an information, it's not about the name, okay. Yeah, it's ISO itself has got an information with this VMware workstation has, was able to detect. If it is a Windows IO, so you have detected a Windows system. It's a, there's another option, I will install the operating system later, the virtual machine will be created with a blank hard disk, right? So this we will do in the customized thing. So just here it is a basic installation which will help you to install everything. Everything means whatever is basic needs. So next. Okay, so personalized Linux, that means you want to give some name to this particular OS, okay, not the host name. So I will give that rel 7.7, okay. So here, you need to give, what to say, a username. So by default, I'm giving a username as Liju. You can give your name, okay. Just ensure that you give it in small letters and without space and all those things. So this is the username with which you can log into the system. Okay, so VMware, what it will do is that it will itself create a user on the Linux operating system. You are not going to do any customization, anything on the Linux, right? Because these are the some fields which will be asked during installation of the OS, which we will see in the customized format. Okay, password, of course, you need to give. So I'm giving a password of Red Hat. So maybe you can also give that so that we don't have to keep remembering the passwords. So now they are not asking for a root account. The root account will be automatically created and the root password will be the same as what you have given here. So please remember that this is not the OS installation what I am teaching you. This is just preparing the environment for OS installation, right? So OS installation here, you will not see anything. It will just directly start. But in the customization format, you will learn about how to install a Linux operating system, right? So enter. And it says that virtual machine name is something like this. If you want to give a different name, you can give. I just giving rel 7.7. Okay. You can see that the location also, it says something like location. It is like in users, my username is Neo and the documents virtual machine is rel. This is where your virtual machine gets stored in, right? If you want to put in separate space, you can put it. Just let the default if you have sufficient space in C. Next. And it asks you that what is the space that you want for this system. By default, it's 20 GB. What is the technique? Or if you want to give more, you can give. But 20 GB is good enough. Good enough. Okay. So because OS will hardly take up maybe less than 2 GB or something like that, the default. Okay, say store virtual machine as a single file. This is good because everything will be in a single file. Okay, but if you want to maybe move the virtual machine to some other thing, so splitting in small files will help you to move to a different machine if you want to save this and all those things. But says for a study purpose, the store machine as a single machine should be good.
Real time,
you don't know. Two workstations, right? Real time, there will be a single image. It's only for study purpose. Next. So, it's just a summary of whatever is given, right? And you can also customize hardware. That means, here you can see that if you look on the customized hardware, it says that there is a memory of 2 GB which is allocated. You can customize it. It is in 2048 MB. You can give in multiples of 2048 MBs. Okay? That means it should be in multiple of 1024. Okay. If you want to give 4 GB, it should be 4096. Right. So, but if your system is basically having only a 8 GB RAM, so basically it's good to give only 2 GB. Processor one is enough. Okay. Number of processors and number of cores. Right. Cores means a CPU will have different cores, which is the execution point. These are hardwares. This is not Linux. Okay. So if I go more into depth of this, when we have time, maybe we can discuss. But we'll go into when we analyze the data of the system, we will explain you more about it. Okay. So virtualization engines, these are all nothing of our interest. So if you want to add more, you can add additional whatever is there, right? Yeah, additional CD drive you don't need, right? So additional floppy drive, you can network card we might need, but this is not applicable for this course. We might be interested, or we would be interested in something called generic SCSI. Okay. First, we finish up this. So after that, you would probably want to add one more thing. That key, if you add this, that's something known as. Disk, okay, that we need to have installed after the way it's installed. So if you just, if the CD-ROM detector, so just you can, what you can do is that basically you can remove, you don't need this at this point of time. I will teach you what after OS installation. So just remove it. So we haven't made any changes. Okay, just we have started again. Customized hardware. So if you want to add, you can add this at this point of time. Later also, you have the features to add it out. Okay, so just go ahead and install the OS to check out, okay, what is the memory. That is 2048, that is 2 GB RAM, and your hard disk of 20 GB. Network settings and all those things, we will not look at this point of time. Clear? So power on the virtual machine after creation. That means so automatically power on. If you don't click this, then you have to manually go ahead and power on. I will show you how to do manually. Finish. So now it has it has created a virtual machine in the system, and it has booting the ISO Linux, correct? It is now booting from the where? ISO image, which we have attached. So you can see that the ISO will boot. Just ignore any errors because we don't have a floppy drive and all those things. So see, now it is booting from the where? ISO image, which we have attached. Okay, it is not going to ask you anything because it is a automated installation. Correct? Everything will be automatically installed. So it might take some maybe 10 or 15 minutes. So you can just go through these steps. Meanwhile, yeah, you can go ahead and start installing. So don't customize anything. Follow the method what I've told you, because customization will look later. Because once it is done, we will do our other practicals, which you can continue, and later we will go ahead with the other ones. Okay, see here, begin installation is not highlighted because it's trying to check all the things. It will take some few minutes. See, it has automatically taken everything because it is doing some check. And then it has started the installation. So all these steps we will do manually in our customized format installation. Okay.
So in the customized format, what we will do is that we will install RHEL 7.6. Okay. Why? Because I will be showing you how to upgrade RHEL 7.6 to 7.7. Clear? So that we don't have to do double works. You are always free to install as many operating systems as your system, but you should have sufficient space. And all these operating systems should not be started at the same time, because if it's started, it gets consumed memory. If it's in a stop state, there is no problem. Right?
Yeah. Sirisha, you're following, right?
Oh yeah, of course, yes.
Yeah, okay.
Just a quick question, did you care?
Yeah.
Was there a specific reason why you wanted to slowly install the VMware workstation? I thought VM player also we could create
one. Yeah, VM player actually, correct. VM player actually allows you to only put one machine. I don't think it is it is allowing you to do more. And basically in Cloud for Green they use VMware workstation. So that's okay. Why I just stick onto it.
Is it because you have licenses for workstation, is it?
Yeah, license. I mean, it's just easily available in Google. You can just take it up and put it on.
Oh, that's okay. The training same purpose. Yeah. Oh, okay.
I basically are a fan of Oracle Virtual Machine, so I use Oracle Virtual Machine for many purposes.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So I just show you maybe how this is Oracle Virtual Machine which I have already.
It's using VM Player as well. I mean, I've got many 3 or 4 running using VM Player. God, I was just wondering, maybe you had a specific.
Yeah, it's a choice. It's not mandatory that you use VMware Workstation. Okay.
Oh no, that's fine. Yeah, just checking. That's it.
So this is something like fine. Which I use basically. This Oracle Virtual Machine box.
Yes, they'll be using the server, right?
Not necessary. So if you have 2 machines in your system, you don't need server. Right? You can use it everything in the system. Right? Of course, I will install Linux on my system and I will show you how the real hardware information, because you won't get all the hardware information here because it's a virtualized environment, correct? So it's up to your choice. That it's not necessary you have to install VMware Pro, but thing is that you need to run 2 operating systems. I mean, 2 instances of Linux at one point of time to do some to show interconnectivity between 2 servers, copying files from one to other. Right?
Okay. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. Okay. 90%
of the in our class, we need only one system.
Okay.
Right. So this is basically an automated customized installation to get you ready for for our class. Correct. So I think possibly tomorrow I will just share the link of 7.6 IS also, so you can upload it. So you can download that 7.6 also. We will install 7.6 as one of the OS later tomorrow, because 7.7 and 7.6 there is no difference. Only some bug fixes, updates, and all those things is here. Correct. So it doesn't matter that we train on 7.6 or 7.7. So what we'll do is that 7.6, why I'm installing it later in the class, I will show you how to upgrade an OS, because upgrading an OS is one of the key component in real-time environment. Okay, these all things will not be taught in any of this, training institutes, or if you go with Red Hat also. These are all customized things what I'm showing. So you need to upgrade a kernel, which is of course one of the question in examination. Okay. They will ask you to maybe upgrade any package. Okay, then you should know how to configure your system as a repository. So we will teach you how to configure a repository, local repository, as well as you want to configure as a remote repository, right? So that also I will teach you. That's the reason of putting up 2 systems. So during the installation phase, this automated installation, it will ask for your root password, ask for your user account, which is not normally required. Root, of course, is needed, okay, without which you cannot continue. And you will also ask to select packages, you will also ask to select partitions and all those things. So what I will do is that we will look on partitions and all those things in the second class, right, in the next class. Then you will understand about partitioning and all those things. So then in the fourth class or fifth class, we will do an installation of 7.6 so that we can come to know about all the difference. Otherwise, what will happen is that all those things get merged and you will have multiple repetitions and all those stuff. So Sirisha, if you have a VMware player in your system, maybe you can try installing Linux in that player.
I think it gets automatically installed when we're trying to install workstations for. So that's what happened on my system. VM player got installed. I could open that. So yeah, I'll try that actually.
try and do the automated installation. Don't do the manual installation. So that everything gets because you don't have to go through the OS installation parts and all those things. VMware will do it automatically for you. Just like I've shown you right here. Hello.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So VMware will automatically do it for you, the OS installation and everything. So we can go ahead and start with our labs. So if you're not following your labs, I mean your OS is not getting installed, not a problem. Another day of the class when you're free, you can just call me or ping me.
I'm trying to see. I mean, I could open the console on VM player, so I think it works. It doesn't need a license.
Yeah, that doesn't need a license.
Correct. Yeah, it's a freeware. I was just wondering. I would have done it last night, but I wanted to check with you if there was any.
Because I'm not sure that you could install multiple operating systems on VMware player.
I mean, you can run multiple virtual machines. Not multiple operating systems on the same machine. I don't know.
So you can run multiple versions of the same OS, correct?
Multiple versions of the same.
Yeah, maybe you can check that.
In Windows, definitely yes. Because when I was working, so we used VM player, so we used to have like 3 or 4 virtual machines running.
You can use VMware player. Go ahead and install Linux. So that should be good.
As long as we are not using any specific functionality that workstation has and VM player
doesn't have. Right.
Until then, that point.
Yeah, no problem. You're free to. And please ensure that if you have limited RAM in your system, so ensure that the other any of the operating systems running as a virtual machine in a VMware player, that should be shut down or an off state.
On this system, no, I don't have any, honestly. Okay. Not on this system, so that would be a new one. So I have enough space and enough RAM on my laptop.
Correct. So perfect. You can go ahead and check the OS installation. So once it's done, John, we'll move it with other tasks, right?
Okay, perfect. Okay, thank you. I'm trying to create that virtual machine, but I think I haven't downloaded.
Yeah, please.
Yeah.
Maybe it's fine, it will take some time to do better.
He's installing the Enterprise Linux 7.64 bit.
There are chances in this is basically you are doing in laptops, right? Mm-hmm. So depending upon your laptop's hard disk and all those things, sometimes the OS might hang in between because these are not enterprise ready products, right? Your hard disk, your memory, everything counts, right? It's not the problem with the OS installation part, it's basically the problem with the hardware or the infrastructure what they're using, right? So if it gets stuck, not a problem. You can go ahead and delete the thing and the existing VM and reinstall. first one. So here in my thing, you can see that performing post-installation setup task. So that means the OS packages and all those things have been completed. Post-installation means what? After the installation. That means it could be configuring the systems and we have created users and all those things, right? The root user and all those things, right? So those are like post-installation things. So that will take some time actively for normally. And here you can see that that is also completed, generating and all those stuff. So the OS installation is almost done in my case, right? So you can see that my system installation has completed and it has rebooted, okay? And now it is booting from my OS, not from the ISO. The installation has completed and it has rebooted. So here you can see that my operating system getting loaded, right? I log in as root with my password, right? It is there. I can even log in to the system as user Liju because I have created this user. Right. So if there is any failed attempt or something like that, it will give you a message. Last login failed on when date on TTY1. So TTY1 is the terminal where you log in basically. So it says there has one login attempt since the last successful login. So if I try logging as Liju by giving a different password, doesn't work. Again, I try to do a different password. Okay, doesn't work. So I give the password again with correct password and it gives me that there are two unsuccessful attempts, okay, two failed attempts logging in, which is last during after the last successful login. That means you logged in and later someone was trying to log in as root, sorry, as Liju. So did it started?
Yeah,
started, no? So it'll take some time, 10 minutes something. Okay, so what we'll do is that meanwhile we'll start. Sirisha, you were able to start the installation?
No, not yet. So you can continue, but okay. I think okay. I know this process, so I'll do it. Yes.
So I just go into my old OS. So this I will shut down. I think it's the same thing. I just need to ensure that. So yesterday we spoke about redirections, correct? How do you redirect an output of a command to a file, right? Today we will learn about some more redirections, like how can you redirect an output of a command and give it as input to some other thing, some other command. And we will also learn that if there is an error in the screen that you see, that for example, you're doing ls minus l on a directory which is not present, it will give error, correct? Or you're creating a file of the same name which is already present, it will give error, correct? So how do you redirect these errors to somewhere, right? Maybe to a file which you want to use it as a log, or you see that these errors are useless, you don't need, you maybe can dump it to a empty path, okay? You'll see that. And could be possible that you want to redirect your output. Like for example, we saw yesterday, right? Cat etc red hat -fn release. You want to redirect that output to a file, right? So that is what we are going to learn today. And many more things are there which we will be learning. So let's start with that. So maybe what I will do is that there is a command called before that, what I will do is that I will basically minimize this and I will use putty. That's more, I'll just customize 42 so that you people can see the screen a little more bigger. Now you can see that data is a little bigger, right? Mm-hmm. You are not seeing it, right? Okay. No problem. I will share the 42 screen. I'll just what to do is that stop sharing, and I can see this. That is little bigger, right? Or do you want more bigger?
Yeah.
Is good? Okay. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to do a simple redirection. Cat etc redirect. We saw this yesterday. I'm going to redirect it to a file inside temp called system data. The file is not present, but it has automatically been system data. Correct? Yeah? Let's create it. Right? Simple direction. Yesterday we saw this. So now I'm going to create a directory called test. See this? In time we have something called as test.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to touch some files into this. So I will give you another example of touch here. Yesterday we saw that how do you touch multiple files, right? We have seen how to create multiple directories using braces and all those things. So here there's another example of brace. See, I've already created a file called test. Inside that, I'm going to create file from 1 to 5. That is file 1, file 2, file 3, file 4, file 5. But please ensure that key, this dot should be only 2 dots. You cannot have 3 dots. It will not work.
Bracket
should be floor bracket, not any other bracket. Okay, curly braces. So enter. So when you do a slash temp test, you will see that there are 5 files created, empty files. You just want to create 5 files. Otherwise, what you're going to do? Touch file 1, file 2, file 3, file 4.
File comments.
So if you, this is 5 files. But what happens if you have got to create 1000 MP files?
1.test.1000.
So with single command, you can create 1000. But what would happen? You have to enter the 1000. Right. This is how you save time and all those stuff, right? So now you are going to redirect the output. Okay, you just want to redirect the output of a particular command to. So I'll just show you here. There is a directory called slash temp test, correct? But there is, I'm trying to do ls minus l on another directory called slash temp tmd. Okay, see, this is possible. You want to do ls minus l on slash tmp, correct? Slash maybe out, last slash is not required, but even if it is there, automatically you put tab, it will come up. Okay, and you do a slash temp on test. This is acceptable. See, you will give an output of temp and output of test in separating. Okay, so this is what I'm going to do here. Slash ls minus l on slash and temp and this. So what I'm going to do is that I did this and I say ls cannot do slash temp new because no such file or directory, but it has given me output of slash temp test because it is there, correct? Now what I'm going to do is that I want to redirect the output of what ls minus l command to a file called temp log. Log is not present, it automatically create. So have you seen the output of ls minus l? No, you have only seen the output of error. Correct. There is an error. There was an error here also. Correct. The same command executed. But do you get the output here? No. Where it has gone? It has gone to slash temp log. Because I have redirected. Correct?
Can you recall?
Okay. I have in the first command, I have just did a ls minus l on test step and temp. Everything is on the screen. For some purposes, maybe during a scripting or some other purpose, I want to redirect the output to a file. I don't want to see in screen. So what I do is that I redirect it. See, I'm not appending it. I'm just redirecting it. That means the file will be overwritten. So I redirect it. So do you see the output of ls minus l here? No. You only see the error. Why the error is there? Because this directory is not present. Slash n new.
Okay.
But where the output has gone? It has gone to log. See? Slash temp test. This ls minus l output is there. It has been redirected to slash temp log. Right? So here what you have learned? You have learned that how to redirect an output of a command to a file. Clear? Now what we are going to do is that you are going to learn how do you redirect both errors and the output to a file. Correct? Got it? That is also there. Or you want to only redirect the error to a file. So, okay, let's see that. Let's redirect only the error. So I'm going to I'm going to redirect it. This space is not mandatory, even this put it like. Now what will be the output here? No problem.
It will be to move into temp error log. Error is
what will move? What will move?
So L minus L.
See here the output will be moved to error log. But I want the only the error.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this file name is nothing. I can put any other file name. Okay, so I just to show you, I'm putting error log. So my here objective is only to move the error. The actual output which is successful should be shown in the screen. Correct? So in order to do that, I am using two.
Right. Okay.
Two means the error will be redirected. Only the error will be redirected. So please write the command only when I have finished it.
Okay.
Okay. Right. So our first command was this, where only redirection was there to some file. But now my objective is to only redirect the error. I want to show the successful output in the screen, but error I don't want to see. So see, do you see the error here? No. But the error is still there. Where has it gone? It has gone to slash temp. See, the error has gone there. That means this concept is very important. Okay, specifically when you are writing bash scripts or whatever, Python, whatever it is. Okay, this redirection is very important.
Sir, this error log will be here.
Error log is any file. You can give your name also. This is just to identify that I am redirecting a file called slash temp error log. Right? You can give XYZ also. Just to understand that key, I am putting errors into this file.
My question is here, but we haven't used to create a new error log. It's a new file, right?
Yeah. So if the file is not there, it will automatically create.
Oh, it will automatically.
It will then. If you put redirection.
If you put redirection, then no need to give like touch.
No need. That's why I shown you, right? In the yesterday's class, I told you echo is greater than and put there.
But directory we use minus p.
Directory you need. You can't create a file inside a file. You can't create, right? So for that minus p is not required. Here minus
here p. For text files, it's directly if you redirect it,
it will go there. Directory you cannot redirect. So here the objective is that you need to understand the difference between a directory and file. Directory is like your this thing, drawer, correct? Or like your cupboard or wardrobe, where you store something. So I take an example of a table where you have a drawer, right? What do you do in that drawer? You keep something. What do you keep? I keep a file, a folder.
Yes.
Or best example is I keep a notebook.
Yes.
Consider notebook as a file. Can you keep another notebook inside a notebook?
No.
Correct? So notebook is the end object. Correct? So you cannot create another file in a file. You can write more into the notebook. Correct? You can have one notebook for maybe accounts, another notebook for students details. You can have another notebook
for maybe the daily expense and all those things or whatever it is. Okay.
So here I just created a file called error log. So you can already create or you just can redirect it. So if the file is not there, automatically it will create. See, these concepts are very important and this will be applicable when you write a script. Okay, please be very careful that, please be very attentive and understand this concept. Because in middle of the class, I will give you assignments, right? Maybe next class onwards when everyone has got the system. So once the class is finished, you need to complete your assignments and show me. And the assignments will be based on these concepts, what we have learned. So what we will do is that key end of the class, that means end of this whole class session or this course, we will build a script periodically. That means what we learn. At end of the script, we should be able to capture or capture some system information using a bash script.
Mm-hmm.
Correct. So we will do it one by one. So something you learn, you write a script, and another day when you learn something more, you will add more to this script once you have fine-tuned it. Got it? So please practice this concept and ask me if you are not clear with this. So first thing what we learned is about redirection. Redirection what? Redirection to the screen, which successful output of commands. If the command is not successful, it will show error. Clear? So now you have two things. What? You have got an output, successful output of a command, and second is you have error.
Yeah, rewriting the error.
Correct. So something is that you are running a script and you want to show it to the screen, but you feel that there is some error and it's showing. It is annoying. You don't want to see this error. Correct? So what do you do? You want to have a mechanism which will redirect only the error to some file. So that is what we learned here. So in order to redirect only the error, okay, only error, you need to do 2> Clear? Now we have learned both things. File 1, 2, 3. Okay. So what I'm going to do is that I want to redirect both the error as well as the output to a file. File is of your choice. Here I'm saying that redirect to /temp file 1, 2, 3. If the file is not present, it will create it. So the output is also not there, error is also not there. But when you look on /tmp file 1, 2, 3, you can see the error is also there, the output is also there. Correct? This is what you get when you issue this command. Same thing. Any difference? No. It's the same thing, correct? Cat temp file 1, 2, 3.
Redirect, we don't get any results.
Yeah. In the screen you don't, because you are redirected.
Yeah. Suppose if you find commit any mistakes also, we couldn't be able to find.
See, this object is difference, right? You are writing a script in which you don't want any output of a screen. Correct? You don't want any output on a screen. Right? Correct?
So basically, this will be like in any applications, if any error is throwing,
yes,
you don't want other users to affect it. They'll get
and not other user, you don't want to see the errors on the screen. You want to redirect to something in. So once the screen is completed, this is a small script. The big script will be of 1,000 lines, 2,000 lines, 3,000 lines, or many other purpose. So maybe you want to see that error message. If it is there. If no error message, you know that everything is successful. Clear? Now, there are situations where you don't want errors to be put in. Why do you want to? I mean, you know that there are some errors which you know that is purposefully there, but you are least bothered about key to point it to some file. So Linux
has something known as slash /davinum. I will talk about these files later, but for time being, understand that there is a file called slash /davinum. There's a file there. We'll talk about these files later, but understand that there's a file called slash /davinum. Null is like a empty, well, right, which don't have any bottom,
like
backholds. Right, you put anything,
yeah,
it will dump.
It will accept.
It will go.
Can you spell it for BOTTR? Bottom. What you said, I can get it.
You can put as black hole.
Black
hole. It's just like a well with empty bottom. I mean, there is no bottom inside that.
Whatever we dump,
it will not say that. It will go. Right? There is no space where it will actually go and accumulate. So you can just consider it as a black hole. You understand black hole, right?
Yeah.
Right. So black hole conceptually, you put anything, it will absorb.
So once we
can't retrieve it. You can't retrieve it. Gone. It's empty space. Right? So you want to throw it as a trash. Right? So now what I'm going to do is that these all things, I'm not going to show it again and again, but consider that the errors you don't want. And what I'm going to do is that I'm going to redirect the error to where? Null. See? The output is there, but the error has gone to null. The same.
You can't retrieve back.
No, you cannot retrieve back. So the same thing is that if I redirect this, it doesn't show any meeting. Means you haven't seen any output also. It has gone to null. This is useless command, but it works. What my objective of saying is that you can redirect something to a location
which not required at all.
Yeah, not required at all, which you cannot retrieve back. It's just like a dump area. So it's up to you that how usefully you use it. So this is a command which is working fine, but this is of no use. But this command is of use because you are redirecting error to a null which you don't want, but the output you want. Correct? Clear? Now, there is another command. We will teach you about grep and all those things. Okay. Grep. So for timing, understand that grep is a command with which you can basically look for specific patterns or specific word or anything like that. So there is a file called slash /etc hosts. Okay. So this basically has got, normally when a system is installed, it will have entry of only the loopback address. 127.0.0.1 is the loopback address, and a local host.local domain, this is the name which it gets over there. So basically this file should contain what? This file should contain your IP address. Okay, don't write to the contents of this file. Just
the command.
Just put slash /etc host. Okay, identify that. Why this file? This you want to identify? What is the importance of this file? This is a system file. It's not a file which I have created. Okay, this is very important file. So this, normally this file should populate with your IP address, your FQDN, fully qualified domain name, and your short host name. That means only the host name of your FQDN, host name part of your FQDN. Now, this is a simple file. I just want to show you that how you can search for some criteria and get it. So the objective of showing this command is to show you how you can redirect an output of a command. This is output of a command, right? To another command. Grep is a command. So how do you redirect that? You use something known as pipe. This is known as pipe. Pipe grep. Right, and I'm saying that I want to search something. Grep is used to search some pattern of files. So I am saying that I want to search local host. Okay, or I will say that I want to just search 127. Correct? I'm searching 127 because I know that 127 is there in this thing. If you search something which is not there, it will not produce anything. So what it will do is that it will produce only the first line because the line which has got 127. So So the grep is a command which you use to search for particular pattern or line. We'll learn about grep later in this class if we have time today, otherwise on the next class, right? So what we have learned here is that how to redirect one command output to another command using a special character called pipe. As you learn more commands, you should be able to use this, but you should know that if the second command you are giving can take the output of first command, correct? It doesn't mean that you are running a user or command and you are giving an input as slash etc release to it. Will not take it up, correct? Yeah. So I am taking another example of slash ls minus l slash. Correct. This is the output of a command. I want to display pipe root. Display only the command, only the thing which is root. Okay. So why it has shown root all? Because the root is there, right?
Yes.
Root is there.
Yes.
So even though it is correct, but our objective is not met basically. So I'm going to do something known as proc. It will only display a line having proc. Got it? Or I'm going to display line something known as lib. So it are two lines where lib is present. Whether it is starting, beginning, or end, or where, it doesn't bother. It will display all the lines which has got lib. So the objective of showing this is to make you understand the use of pipe for how to redirect one command output to another command output.
Proc means what is the?
Proc is a directory. Yeah. Lib is a directory. So don't bother about what is it.
The same file or a directory will put a grep paste as it.
Grep, not file or directory. I am going to search. See, ls minus l output, it has nothing to do with directory and file here, for my case.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You see that these all things are there. But when you redirect to a file, it will just consider it as a text.
Okay.
No command or directory, that is not bother about. So when you do a grep will only search for the pattern what you are giving, irrespective of whether it is directory, file, or whatever it is. It will only search for something here as an example, anything which matches lib, whether it is directory, file, or whatever it is, permission name, what if it is as. Okay. So that is what we are going to, what we have looked on. Clear? Okay, this clear? So what we have done, we are known as your standard input. Okay, your standard input is basically your keyboard. Standard input means, because with mouse you are not going to input anything, even you can copy paste, but you consider as a keyboard because you are putting something. Okay, your keyboard is a standard input, or it's called STDIN. You can write it that STDIN is known as standard input. STDIN, single word. STDIN, small letter. You can say that it is standard input. STD out, it is known as standard output. What is the standard output?
Screen
is your standard output. Okay. Or if you are redirecting to a file, then file becomes your standard output. Correct? It depends on what, but normal case, your screen is your standard output. Then your standard error. Where is the error displayed? Where is the error displayed normally? Screen. Correct?
Yes.
Error is also displayed in the screen, as we have seen that, right?
Yes.
In that example. But you want to display that error or put that error in somewhere. So that file can also become a redirect. So standard error, standard input. That is STDIN, standard output STD out, and standard error is STD ERR.
And what is the example for standard input?
input what we have put up.
Means command. We'll
be setting command. Whatever command, that is the standard. So, so difference between redirection and pipeline. Pipelining is the pipe symbol which I showed. What is the difference? Redirection is to redirect the output of a command, whether it is output of command or error, to a file. That means you are redirecting something. Instead of putting it to a screen, you put it somewhere. Pipelining or piping, what you call is, you are redirecting the output of a command to some other command.
Means some specific we have mentioned, that's why
redirecting the output of a command to some other command. So that command should be able to process this output. So that's why I gave an example of command. For example, there's a command called userAdd, which is able to add only userAdd, adding a user. So into that command, there is no need, or it doesn't add any value of putting an output of error to that particular command.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes. But normally, like instead of the pipeline command, what we're using, like ls minus l, is only with specific inside the directory.
Inside the directory, or you can put in some other directory, ls minus l slash. If you are in temp, you can put ls minus slash l to give the specific directory output where you are in. If you want to give a specific directory, slash, for example, slash ls minus l slash etc http, where http is a directory. So you will get output of ls minus l slash etc httpd in that directory. Okay. Okay. One more thing which I haven't told you yesterday. It is just an example. Maybe possibly you can look for the help, because ls, there are a lot of switches. Most of the switches, it's like up to you that key, how you want to learn, but most of the switches in normal case, it is not useful. Okay, but specific commands like ls minus ld, d means directory. For example, you want to see permission of temp. How will you see? You can do ls minus l slash, sorry, ls minus l temp. We'll teach you about permission later. Just understand that you want to see some more details about it. But okay, you are saying slash temp,
yes.
Correct. But if you want details about temp, temp is not here, right?
Yes.
How do you can see ls minus l? The temp is there, correct? Where is the temp?
Yes.
Green color, correct? Yes. But what if you want to see the details of slash?
So
ls minus ld. If you want to give specifically that directory, okay, so it will give only the permission of that directory. See, the same thing, correct? So slash is also a directory, a tool, root directory. So you see, what is the permission? So remember this, okay? Nowadays no one will do it, but always remember the permission of slash. What is the permission of slash? See, this is the permission of the slash. Just know this. We will teach you how to look at the permission. Okay. So ls minus ld, d means directory. So if you have to specific, not the contents in that directory, okay, of the specific directory, okay, it could be some directory inside. So if you can put as temp test, it could be this special, even if it is slash also. Same. You're looking for the details of slash temp test directory. Okay. Clear? Okay, so I've told you about redirection. So redirection, instead of single greater than symbol, you can put double greater than symbol. I need not to tell you that key, why it is there. If you want to append the logs,
yeah,
so adding it. Okay, if you're just adding it to Davy null, it doesn't make any matter. But if you're putting double greater than on a redirecting the output of a command to a file, it will append. Otherwise, it will delete it. The previous, only the fresh one will be stored. Correct? Okay. So now we will learn about the text editor. There are a lot of text editors in Linux. Okay, text editor.
We have something.
So there are a lot of text libraries like VI, Vim, Pico, Nano, many things are there. Okay, you don't need to learn everything. Only one is enough. So Vim or VI, it is nothing. Vim is a improved version of VI. Okay, VI, if you put, you will see mostly if you look for a scripting or something like that file, you will see normally in blank color, white color. Okay, but if you put Vim, you will see in colors, like some commands you will put in some color, some other thing you will be in different colors. That's a different bit. Okay, so those things we can go with Vim. Right? So VI is the older version, Vim is the new version. So every version you will see Vim. Okay, so we'll look on Vim. So basically, first thing, so some people might tell you that hey, there is another editor like Pico editor, Nano editor, which is good. But Vim provides most of the functionalities.
This would be common on all the
distributions. Right? All the distributions Vim will. Some distribution Vim might not be there, only VI will be there. Again, older version, something, very old version. So Vim is something which you are going to learn. Please understand that Vim has got many, many, many features. Okay. So just issue Vim. So before that, if you issue any command, just check out that key, which where is the command? And yesterday I also told the another command, where is, right? To show you the command location and other parts. So the binary executable is this thing. This is the command which you're going to run. Either it can give you the full path, this is the absolute path, or just Vim is, you know, we will talk about why just invoking Vim opens up that Vim. Okay, that we will learn later in this class, if time permits, otherwise in next class. So Vim should be followed by some file name. If it is a new file, you have to give a new file. Otherwise, you can give the absolute path of the file or relative path. Or if you want to edit the existing file, you can give the existing file. So listen carefully. So I'm taking you, there's a called new file. I'm creating a new file here. Okay, could be any name. Enter. It will open up a new thing and the file name will be shown here. This is a file name. This is what you're telling me. This is a new file, not this new file name. Okay. Yeah, the file name is newfile. This they are saying that this is a new file. This is not a new existing file which you're editing.
The quoted one will be the
name. Correct. Now, the VI editor has got, or Vim editor has got two modes. Two modes. One is command mode and second is insert mode. Okay. If you want to type something, okay, you want to press I, small letter I. Ensure that your caps letter is not on. Caps on is not on.
Okay, inserting means like what we do, command.
Yeah, you want to write something, not command. You want to write something to the file, right? You want to get into insert mode. Two modes are there. One is command mode and second is
insert.
Command mode, or you can call it as escape mode also, ESC. Okay, so you have to get to insert mode, press I. Now you can see that you are ready to type here. Otherwise, you will not be able to type. So I'm saying that I'm typing something. My name is Viju. Right? You can type till wherever you go. You have to go in commander line, new line. Press enter.
It's like MS WordPad.
Just like your WordPad only, or Notepad, whatever it is. You cannot format it. You cannot put bold and all those things, nothing. It's just a text editor. Like your Notepad, Note Plus Plus, all those things. Okay. I'm your Linux trainer. Right? End means it will take you to the end. Home means it will take you to home. You want to type something in the front?
Aye.
Right? So maybe I had to put maybe a hash here. So that means I can do backspace, all those normal things. And I'm your Linux trainer for this. Month.
Okay. Enter. New line. Good. We will learn Red Hat Linux. Right. Now I want to write to this file. It is not saved anywhere.
Yes.
So what you do is that in order to write, there is something known as command mode. You need to get into command mode. So whatever commands you are going, insert means you are only writing. If you issue some commands to this, that means save and all those things or many other commands, you need to get into escape mode or command mode. So just press the escape key. Once is enough. Once the escape key is pressed, then you have to issue the what? This thing is shift. Shift this full colon. Shift full colon.
Okay.
Full colon.
Oh, okay, double
comma. Yeah, full colon. Not inverted comma. Double dot.
Yeah.
Double dot, which is above the semicolon in your laptop. In your key. In your key. You see that semicolon? Where is semicolon?
This is the one right here.
Yeah, one above that. Yeah, that is. In order to do that, you have to press shift, right? So shift, this thing. And then you need to write. See, this is case sensitive. So W is small letter. So now enter. So full colon W means, how do you want to write? Escape full colon W. That means it will say that 5 lines, 86 characters written in the bottom. See? So now it is saved. Now you want to come out of this file. How do you want to put? Escape again. Since it is an escape, it is not an insert. If it is an insert mode, it will show I insert at the bottom. Escape, command mode. Insert mode. Escape, command mode. So now again you have to press full colon and Q. Enter. Now you are quit the file. Hello, you can see there is a new file called new file. You can see cat new file. Whatever you have written is there.
We can write together, right?
So yeah, I will teach you. Okay. So I'll open this file again. Vim new file. So now see. In the bottom, it is not showing that new file because this now is not a new file, it's an old file. So here, either if you want to write a new line, see the when you open the line cursor will be in the first line of the last thing. Okay, or wherever the line is. So now if you want to add a new line, get into insert mode, come to end and press enter. Correct? If you don't want to, so maybe I have written something here. I don't want this. Correct? I don't want this information to be saved. Right? So what you can do is that escape, full colon, quit. It gives you an error that you have made some changes to this file. You cannot quit. If you want to quit, you want to put Q exclamation mark. That means you are forcefully quitting. So now you are opening this file. You can see that whatever things you have entered later on, before saving this thing, it is not there. So you should be very careful how you want to use it. Correct? Now there is another command. Like you are already in a file, you are in escape mode. Correct? You are on the last line. Correct? You want to add a new line. Either the method I can show, which I have shown you, you can use insert, come to the end, enter. Or what you can do is that in the escape mode itself, you can put what? O. Just O. Small letter O. Just type small letter O. In the escape mode, not insert. In the escape mode itself, or command mode itself, just type O or press and O. So you see that there is a new line which has come up. Next line. Right? You are in this line. You can come, you want to write here, or you want to write after this line.
Just press, you're in command mode. Okay, just you can see bottom which mode you are in. Okay, now you're just pressing O. O should be in small letter. So your caps letter should not be on. Just press O. So insert will automatically come up and it will open up a new line. Got it? So if you are in a line and you want to open it some line above, like for example in Excel, you are right. Insert a card after this or before that, above this, right? So here if you want to do, put shift O.
Means to delete the
column. No. Shift O means above the one line above. See, this is here. See, this is your reference line.
Mm-hmm.
Look here. This is your reference line.
Mm-hmm.
Either you can write below this line or above this line. So imagine like this. You don't have any space here. So I'm in this line. I want to write something after this line. So what you need to do? Just O. Correct? If you want to write above, shift O. Correct? Shift O means caps letter O. When you are pressing shift, yes, O means caps letter. Small letter O means after the line. Caps letter O means above the line. But in order to do that, you don't have to put caps letter on. Then you will forget to do that. Correct?
Yeah.
Then I can write something here. Could have entered price Linux 7.7. Okay. Now I want to write and quit both at the same time. Most of the time, what you do is that escape mode, full colon, write and quit. WQ. Gone. Open up the file again. I'm in a new line. Why it is a new line? Because I have entered this line before. Okay. Now I am typing something. I am into insert mode and I'm in the thing. Either you don't want this. Okay. Or maybe you have written so many lines and you are write and quit and you have started again. Okay, you want to delete these slides. So whatever line you want to delete, just come there and press in the escape mode, press DD. Small letter D twice. Again DD, again this line. If you press again DD, that line will also go.
Escape button and double
DD, double D, small letter. Okay, now I got this much lines.
It's not like can't put everything, select all and delete. You can't do like that.
My option is not there. I want to delete only two lines. Correct. I'm showing you. See, when you write code or all this, whatever is it, this mainly will be used in writing codes or something. You're not going to write documentation in this, right? Even though people who are working in command node text man, they use this. Right. So I want to ensure that I have to selectively do things. Correct. So I want to delete maybe 5 lines from here. You know that I need to delete 5 lines. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Maybe 6 lines. So bring to the area. Bring to the area or line from which you have to delete. If you bring here, then that will line also be deleted. Bring the cursor to the line from which you want to delete. So you are in escape mode.
Yes.
6 DD. So at the bottom line, you can see 6 fewer lines. Right? Then what you do? You can write. Or if you can quit, write and quit. But what I did is that after doing this, I realized that I don't want to delete it. But if you write, it's saved.
Yeah, only.
But before writing, write means it's just like you're saving the file. I'm not saved. It's in memory right now. I don't want to delete the line and realize it should not be deleted. So what you can do, escape mode and U. Undo.
Control.
Yeah. Undo. See, these are very useful and very effective
things when you basically code. Correct? And now again, I want to delete maybe 8 lines. Escape, delete. Right? Write and quit. So that's gone. Now you cannot do, you can't get to the older. This is already at the older stage. Okay. Now if I keep pressing D, so it will delete all the lines below. It's just like DD. Right? So now what I'm going to do is that I want to copy these lines. Which one? These 4 lines. Or I want to copy only these 2 lines. So wherever you want to copy.
From where?
From where you have to copy. If it is only single line, just escape mode and YY. Young. Okay. And come to the bottom line. Okay. Press O or insert mode, wherever it is. If you want to paste here, press enter. Escape mode, P. Command or commands what issue, those would mean escape mode. Okay. If you just type P, P will be written here if you are in insert mode. So command should be in P. How many times in escape mode you put, it will all get printed.
Escape plus P.
Escape, escape, escape. Now I want to yank or copy these 4 lines. So from where I want to copy, just bring the cursor to there. Now this escape mode 4, bye-bye. Just like your DD. So you say that 4 lines yanked. Yanked means copied. So bring to the location where you want to put it. Okay. And P, 4 lines copied. Paste it.
My question is that in case of something like before, like my name is there, instead of that we put some code, a number, instead of a sentence, we put some coding number. Does that escape 4YY to work or to give some throw error?
No, no. For example, you have this line in open mode. 4. For example, you have something as 4YY.
Yeah, 4YY.
Oh yeah. 4YY. Okay. You are in insert mode. That's why I told you. You have to differentiate between insert and command line mode. Command line mode, if you are in escape mode, whatever you type, it will not come. I just type in Y, I guess. Okay. So other 3 modes which are not useful explanation. In latest one, I guess there are some other commands also. A also gets inserted. S also gets inserted. So, just as I, there may be maybe keyboard thing. So what I told you is about, like you are asking about 4YY. Okay. So once you are in escape mode, it will not get typed. So you can easily write 4. What do you want to write? 4 by y. Correct? Then you have to do put O. From here I have to paste. And I have to come in the escape mode P. I'm typing because there is no lines after this. So I'll put something on this 4. Maybe here. 4YY. Okay. And command mode. Now I do maybe 4YY. I have copied 4 lines. Yeah. So till which line it will copy? It will copy from here. 1,
right.
2, 3, 4. Till here it will copy. And I put P and I put P. 4YY is copied. Correct? So it depends upon where, whether you are in command mode or whether you are in insert mode. So that is very important. So when you type something, so this comes through practice only. You have to practice a lot, at least for some time, so that your VI editor is good enough. So once it is over, it is just a piece of cake. You just need to differentiate between insert mode and command mode. So daily, what I used to do is simple thing. When I learned, what I do to do is that key daily, at least for 10 minutes, not more than that. 10 minutes, open VI editor, type something. Use all the commands which are shown. Don't learn mode. Only this is enough.
Delete, copy, paste.
This is very useful when later on you will start coding or whatever it is. Okay. Because it is very useful. Correct. If you remember all those things, this is more than it. I don't know most of the stuff, like maybe other DD I use or other Word also you can copy, but that's not needed in day-to-day life. And specifically once you are using the mouse, what you can do is that you can just put a copy like this and put it over here and just paste. Big lines and all those things you will do. But people who are experts in VA editor, they don't need mouse. They are more faster than mouse. Okay. Yeah. And then you do write and quit. So this is very important, and you should know that you should not make mistakes before, because I told you I will be teaching all the native methods, right? So many of the times you will be editing file to make changes. Like yesterday I told you, I will show you how to change the host name by editing file. So if you don't know how to use VA editor properly, your command thing goes, anything goes wrong in the thing, your system name will also go wrong, your system will not get communicated, many other stuff will be. Okay? Okay, now something very important. You want to search something in the file. Imagine there's a big file. I just open another file called slash var log message. This is a message file. This is a system file. Okay, it's a very long file. Okay. Clear? I want to search something known as Bluetooth. Got it? You can quickly look on. If you want to search again, you are in escape mode, okay? They are not in insert mode. You have to press N. If you want to scroll upwards, it is downwards. Downward search. If you scroll upwards, press Shift and N. That means caps letter. You go backward. See the cursor? See the cursor, green color. Correct. If I put caps small letter N, it will come down. Caps letter N, go up. Okay. Clear? Got it? So this is useful when you work as a system administrator.
Page up, page on,
yes.
Page
so no, not page up and page down. You want to search a word. How can you? I mean, this would be like 10,000 lines.
Yes, sir. No, single.
It could be 10,000 lines. You cannot scroll each and every line, all those things. Correct. You need to learn. For example, specifically, you might be interested in looking into a word called error. Yeah, luckily we don't have any error. Okay. Or maybe you want to specifically look for case sensitive. Okay. So you want to be very sure that what you are searching for. So in a big file, you want to just search for error or something like that. Or you want to search something known as kernel. Those are all the kernels. Or you have to search something known as memory. See? It shows us something known as memory free. So it depends upon what you want to search. Clear? What do you want to search? Okay. So this is something what you call as search. So how do you search? Escape slash and then put the word. Clear? So this is useful in specifically looking through the logs to identify if you want to identify some error or some problem. Maybe I want to search for reboot. There's no reboot here.
Clock.
Sorry?
Clock.
Clock. Okay. Whatever it is. So what you are interested in, basically, you can search for that, so that this basically to make you understand that key, how do you refine yourself in a big, very big log file. Another example,
they could be, you are editing a configuration file which is of maybe 500 lines or maybe 100 lines. You can't go through all the things and on. So if you want to edit a single parameter, instead of scrolling down there, you can just directly search, come to the parameter, edit that parameter. Got it? Okay. Now, I'm coming back to my old file, /temp. What is the file which I'm looking for? New file. Okay. There could be, if it's a standard configuration file, and you want to see that, what type of, on where it is basically, that particular line or something, line number basically you want to see. What you do is that, escape mode, colon, set space NU, set number. Right? So if you want to tell your colleague that, hey, if it is a default config file, look for the line number 15. Correct? So basically this happens like when you, for example, what happens is that when you basically look for some files, right, and you want to see that key where this line and all those things is there. Yeah.
This will be common now, except any or
not common. It's only for Vim. Don't look for other editors because other editors are not. I have tested, tried all the editors, but Vim editor is very useful.
It will be in packages that now Vim editor.
By default, it will be installed on the system.
That
it is a package. During package installation, I will tell you what to be installed and what not to be installed. Not to be installed, right? It all depends upon your need, how you can install. Okay, now we will look on very important fact, and this is very useful, specifically when you are working on some things like there could be multiple entries of a thing, right? Multiple entries in a file, maybe 100 entries. You want to go ahead and change all the 100 entries. This is practically difficult thing, correct? For example, I want to change Linux. I want to change Linux
to Windows
to Red Hat Linux.
Okay.
For Windows. Okay. So what I will do is that come into escape mode. Full colon. Small address. S means source. /. Okay. What you want to change? It is case sensitive. That means it is L is in caps letter, L caps letter only you have to give. / to what you want to change. Your wish. That will come to Windows. Okay. So I put G. G means globally. Wherever you find Linux, change it to Windows. Sorry, my mistake. Escape mode. Okay. This thing, full colon. Percentage. Yes. Current source. Linux. To Windows. / globally. So now you see, all the Linux have been changed to Windows.
Same thing, same command only, right?
That's same command, only after full colon, you put percentage sign.
The G, no space.
Everything same.
No space left for G.
No, after slash, same thing. Okay. Let me just show you again. I'm not writing it, I'm just quitting it. So it's not written. So what I do is that, escape mode, percentage
Yes, for source. Then what do you want to replace? Linux with Windows slash G. If you are not putting G, basically what So G basically means globally. Wherever it finds that particular pattern, you want to change that. So full colon percentage slash what you want to change to what you want to change. G. Once again. S slash Linux slash Windows slash G. Okay, you have noted this. Full colon percentage S has been source. What are you going to change? Source, that is Linux. This should match. If it is not matching, it will not find. Then Windows G. Correct? Let's change. Once it is returned, what do you want to do? You have to write and quit. Otherwise, it will not
save.
So now it opened, if the file is having Windows. Clear? So this is all about your Vim editor. Okay. So now we will look on this regular expression. Basically, we will use this. You don't have a very regular expression very detailedly in this course, basically. So basically, Red Hat Linux RSC certification now has got scripting languages and all those things. You can practice regular expressions as and when you need, but if you are looking for a very detailed thing on scripting or regular expression, all those things, there are separate courses which you need to do separately for pass scripting like Python or regular expressions is commonly used for every scripting language what you use, whether it is Python or C or anything. Correct. So for the exam purpose and for the objective of this course to meet, I will teach you regular expression, which is needed for you, and in normal administration cases is more than enough. Okay. Sorry. So regular expression is global regular expression print, that is called GREP. Global regular expression print. That's what you call Vim GREP. That's what you call global regular expression print. Okay, that's what you call GREP. Clear? There's a file just I placed to it. So grep, what it do is that key grep basically scans a file. Okay. Grep basically scans a file line by line. If there are 1,000 lines, it will look for 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 line by line. And if it finds a match, what we are looking for, like in the previous example, we saw that, right? Cat etc slash host slash etc host, we look for 127. So it searches for each line, and if a line is matching, it will print. That's how grep works. Okay, line by line matches the pattern. A pattern is an expression that expresses a string of implementation character or meta character, whatever it is. It could be star, it could be any characters, correct, which you want to basically look for. So I've just for the simplicity purpose, I just return a file here. There's a file called in SLEM. There's a file called messages. I have some written some words here so that we will use regular expression grep to grep that pattern. Grep means it's just like search and find. Okay, grep that pattern. So I will give you some examples here. Okay, if you are in Okay, you're in your system, right?
Yeah.
You're connected, right?
Yeah, connected. You want to
Your Linux is up and running?
No, it's still taking. Still finishing, installing what?
Okay, 10 minutes. Okay, just then you look at here. Okay. So, grep pattern will have this particular pattern. You can write this command: grep space flags and regular expression and file name. Okay, this is the syntax. What do you call?
Good.
Okay. Syntax.
Flag means I think it is like.
Flags is switches. Like yesterday, we saw ls minus l, mm-hmm. ls minus r. Those are switches.
But
or you call it as flags also.
You can't go directly to regular expression and file link directly.
You can do. This is syntax basically.
Mm-hmm.
Some syntax. Some I will tell you what to do. Okay. So this is basically a pattern
mm-hmm.
of a command. Like say, there is a command. For all command, the patterns will be something like this. Okay, there could be some command followed by a flag, or you call it a switch, then followed by some parameters. Okay, file name may not be there, or some commands will be there. Okay, or some parameter will be there. So we can see that slash temp messages file is there. Slash temp messages. Correct. So now here what I'm going to do is that I want to basically search for, you can see that there is error in small letter, error starting E in caps like that, correct?
Mm-hmm.
I want to search for error. So there are two methods basically. I can either do slash temp messages pipe redirection, correct? Not redirection, piping, which we have learned. Grep, you are redirecting this output of this command. What is the output of command? Cat messages. You're redirecting to grep. And you're saying that I want to see something called error, if it is present there or not. So it will show it here. So see a difference. What difference it has says? It has only printed exact match error. Err, okay, or err. So only these two lines it has printed. E hasn't it printed, correct? So there is another method. What you can do is a directly grep, which syntax which I've shown you. Grep, grep pattern or flag. So here we don't have a flag,
yeah,
correct? Grep pattern. Pattern is error, correct? Single quotes, can use double quotes also. Single quotes is something what they say. And then the file name. What is file name?
Message.
Temp. Full path. Correct? You get this?
Mm-hmm. But in VM editor, like how we edit text and all that, directly you can use the grep, hyphen, and the word.
Where you want to see there?
In VM editor, like say we type some text format on everything.
Huh.
And where you can use directly grep hyphen error to show all everything, right?
Vim you cannot use grep. No, grep is not with Vim, right?
Oh.
Did I taught grep with Vim? No. Vim is a separate command. No.
Mark inside you can go.
No, you cannot do. You for that what there is a slash search.
Mm-hmm.
Slash I taught you, right? Slash.
Okay.
Search. Slash. You have to go to command mode, slash. And then search for the word.
Okay.
Grep is different command. It's not associated with Vim.
No, is there any way?
No, there is a way, right? That's what I told you.
No,
the way is slash.
Inside grep inside.
No. No, you cannot use grep inside VM. Okay. So now there is
something, if I want to search for a line which starts with error at the beginning, or I would say that small letter e, error. This character, what do you call it?
Character. Yeah.
Huh? Yeah. So if you put it this at the front, so that will check that whether this error line starts in the beginning or not. So you see, only one is there. Why? Because only this line it is printing. Even though the caps letter error is there, it is not printing that. Why? Because it is looking for the small letter I. This line is not printed. Why? Because it is in the end or maybe in the middle. It is only looking for line in the front. So if I want to look for something like this, so you see, it prints this error in this file. So this line it prints because it looks for caps letter error. Correct? So this is what we learned. What we learned is that how to look for something which starts from the beginning. Okay? So maybe you can look for like this also. Kernel, kernel. See? There's another line called kernel, but this in the middle. But it looks only for the line which starts with K. Caps letter K, E-R-N-E-L. Right? You can see this?
Yeah, got it.
Okay, so now if you want to search for multiple words, for example, I'm just searching for kernel, right? Here we use pipe. This pipe doesn't mean redirection.
Yeah.
Here the pipe means you're looking for multiple patterns. You cannot put use comma. I am using error. I am using red hat. These lines will not give you any output. But when I use minus e, so minus e is a flag. Minus e is a
flag.
So grep minus minus help. So you can see what minus e does. Minus e is extended regular expression. Pattern is an extended regular expression. Okay, so that means by normal grep is not able to identify these multiple lines followed by pattern. This particular pipe character is not able to be identified using grep. So you need to use extended regular expression. So it, what it looks for, it prints all the line with the kernel only K, okay, small letter K, all the lines with error, all the lines with red hat.
Yeah,
okay. Got it? So this is also very important. You should practice. You practice it daily, 10 minutes is enough.
And it's not like we only, as per the, you said, now that starting from first, to put a cap.
Yeah.
To put the last, what left?
Last character is not there. I will teach you what is there. Last, this thing is not there. What to say?
In the
character is not there. Okay. There is another character which we look into. So you can see that there is a line which errors at the last line, correct? So if you want to look that, so what we'll do is that grep and we search for error. Okay. And I will say that look for any line which has got last error in last. So last means in the end you want to place the
dollar
sign. And this slash etc slash term messages. See? Why it has printed the first line also? Because there is no, this itself is the last line. Last. sorry, last word. It is what it is we are asking grep to do. We are asking grep that key look for any line in which error word is in the last of that line. So it finds two lines. Clear? Got it? So there is an example of how to find the last line. So now if you want to match any line in a file temp messages where it starts with numeric, that means 0 to 9. Numeric means 0 to 9, correct? 10 also means
1 and 1. 10.
Yeah. 0 to 9. Look into that. It is not there. But you see that there is a numeric here, right? Why it is not printing? Because we have put up a star here. Mm-hmm. Saying that start. That is start of the line.
Mm-hmm.
Correct? If you just remove the star, it is a look for any numeric on this file there, slash temp messages, where this numeric character is present. It prints those lines. So this is very useful when you write scripts or when you want to extract some data from configuration file. Correct? Or you want to extract some log from a log file of specific pattern. Clear? So advanced regular expressions are there, which you need to load up. Regular expression things are there, which you need to learn or practice a lot, so that you can maybe extract data from many logs and all this. But that requires a lot of practice, and that is beyond the scope of this course. Correct? Any questions on this?
No.
So there is one more thing. Now we have looked for something called, okay, this double quotes is not required, single quotes will also work. Okay. See, grep kernel, yeah, I'm searching for kernel. So it prints only one line kernel, where a small letter kernel is present. There is another line also. There's another line also, which has got kernel here, right? But that is not printed. So if I'm telling grep using flag minus I, that case insensitive.
Mm-hmm.
That means it will print you any word with kernel, whether it starts or ends with, sorry, whether it has caps letter or small letter. Okay, whether it has uppercase or lowercase. Clear? So this is also very important. Clear? So we have learned redirection, error direction, redirecting to null, redirecting to file. Then we have learned about the Vim editor, insert mode, escape mode, or command mode, correct? And different switches, how to use that in the thing, how to replace the text in the Vim editor. Then we have learned how to search a text or pattern in the text editor. We have searched, we have looked into regular expression using grep and grep extension, grep using minus, grep minus E. Instead of using grep minus E, you can use egrep also. Grep minus E, grep minus caps letter E, grep space minus caps letter E is equal to egrep. So you can use people, it all depends upon people like how they want to use. Okay, they want to use grep, so instead of using egrep, they can use, because see, in some scripts the command will be defined initially. You will not use the command again and again, correct? So instead of that, they can use what is a switch directly. Clear?
Yeah,
okay. There is another topic which I will teach now, then after that we will go for a break.
right? This is just 5 minutes topic. So there's a command called DMID code. DMIDECOD. Okay. DECOD.
DMID code.
Okay. This command is basically used to extract hardware information. For example,
recording.
No, recording is there.
Net is gone. VPN is disconnected for me.
For me, disconnected.
Which one are you using?
C4G. Sirisha,
yep.
You there? You can view the screen?
Yes, I can. Yeah.
So it's a problem with the VPN that you connected.
No, it got disconnected automatically. I'm just connecting to the net issue.
Because I'm connected. That's why. She can hear me, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So there's a command called DMID code. For example, you are sitting remotely in India and you are actually managing a server somewhere in different geographical location. Maybe it's in US, Canada, or maybe Germany, or anywhere. In any of the data center is located somewhere. So you can't go there physically and see that key, what is there in the server. Not practically possible. Correct? So, practical example I will give you when this command comes in. Your client have asked that I have some slowness in the system. I face some slowness in the system when I run my application. Okay. My analysts have analyzed and found that there is the RAM need to be increased. The RAM need to be increased or upgraded in the system. Now they say that, yes, please go ahead and upgrade the RAM. Now, you as a client support engineer sitting here, you orders the RAM, right? And the engineer goes there and tries to upgrade the RAM, but they say there's no free slot available. Correct? The money goes in vain since already the purchase is made. Correct? The engineer, everything is gone. The client fires you back saying that, what have you looked at? Correct? So before doing this, you need to check that whether free slot is available in the system or not. Mm-hmm. Correct? Whether the system, so the client asks for a CPU upgrade. Correct? Whether the system supports a higher CPU or not. Clear? The client says that I want to put up an additional NIC card. You want to check that whether there is a slot available where you can put a card. If the slot is not available, then there is no use purchasing the NIC card, right? Then you can say to the customer, hey, there is no free slots available. Probably what you can do is that you need to purchase another hardware with a higher capacity, correct? Because this doesn't support it. So you need to be very precise about information that you need to give the client. So DMI decode is a command. When you issue the command, you will see that there's a big scroll that happens and a lot of things are there. So I will teach you one command here. So DMI decode, you can say when you scroll, there are a lot of things which go on back, but I cannot scroll more, even though I can set in SH to display how much lines to do that. But there is another simple command called any command which is scrolling, which is giving a scrolling output. Pipe. This is another example of redirection. Which piping? You put more. You can see there. Yeah, so DMI decode more, correct? So what it will do is that when you do DMI decode more, it will give you a list of output. More means more. There are more things. So it starts from the beginning. Otherwise, what I did is that when it DMI decode, it scrolls down. I cannot scroll back. Till here, I can scroll. But data is gone. So what I do is that I do a DMI decode more. Or you can do a DMI decode less also. Same thing. Right? If you want to scroll down, press enter or shift. If you want to do page wise. This is not only applicable for DMI decode, for any command. More and less. Okay, so let's stick on to more.
So DMA decode put 5 more. You'll see that. This is giving you information about BIOS information. Vendor is Phoenix. So this is because I am using a laptop. And on which, on top of it, I'm running a virtualization tool. You will find more hardware details when you specifically inform real-time hardware. Clear? So it says that key, how much this is ROM sizes of this BIOS. Okay. What is the release? Okay. And what all things it supports, ISA card, PCIe card, PCIe card, all those information. Right? What firmware version or BIOS revision it is there. In real hardware, you'll find more information of this thing. But more or less, it is the same. Then you will have the serial number. They say that is a virtualized platform. So by looking at the DMI decode, you can identify that whether your VM is a what running in which hypervisor. It could be running in KVM, it could be running Xen, we're running in VMware. So if you want to identify how to do this, you can just do this and grab for manufacturer. Correct? How you can do? Another example, DMI decode, grab for manufacturer. See, you get this? This is another practical example of grep, where you look for and you find a pattern. So just for, don't give this manufacturer web, just only manufacturer is enough. So here you can see that there are a lot of other manufacturers which has come out, right? Because there are other patterns. You do more. So see, so you get this. So in order to filter that, we will see how you can do that later on, right? So look for more information, baseboard information, chassis information, right? Processor information. What is the processor? Gen and Intel. What is the version? Intel release 4i5. See this 4i5, right? 2.30 gigahertz. What is the voltage? All those information you will get. If you got many processors, you will get the information of all the processors over here. So all these information regarding that, all these are processor information. Okay. Process. Now see. Processor information, then it is map, then it has come with memory information. Correct? There's the memory bank. Okay. Now error detection method, there's none because this is a laptop. If it is the error detection method, it will be ECC and all those things, error correction code or what type of it supports, it will be given here. Support interactive on the main current. These are all memory related supported speed. These are speed of memory. Supported types. So you can see that only these type of memories are supported here. Yep. PM, EBO, DIM, dual inline memory, SDRM. Okay, memory voltage. How much memory voltage, the bank pitch, how many voltage, because the manufacturer has got specifications. Only those specifications can be put out. They can also put up in like associated memory slots 15. These memory slots are there where you can put it up. Okay. Then the memory module information, which is there. Socket designation, RAM socket, where there's how many installed. 2GB is installed here, single bank connection. Okay, another 2GB is installed. Then is look on memory module information, location. Then gives you cache information, cache memory information. Then it gives you. So it's got a lot of information. So basically, which you are interested in, so basically you can look into it and take memory device. Right, come on, memory device information, total width. So these are not populated. That's the reason you are not getting information on that. Correct? So let's see more on this particular hardware. So another thing is that 64 memory error and information, is information are not handled well.
So sometime we'll take a printout and we'll see.
You don't need to take a print order, it's big file. So that's where you want to use grep. So there is another information called DMI decode. Instead of putting, you can use DMI decode T type. T0 means it will give you memory information of BIOS. Okay.
T1 means memory information of system information. This is very important because T1 is something which you can get information about the manufacturer. If it's HP hardware, you will get HP. What product name is this? ProLine, DL380, 580, whatever it is. This information you get. Version. They have a particular version because it is virtualization, not a version here. Then if the serial number of that, hardware serial number of that, then UUID of that thing. If it is wake up and power switch, whatever is there, that thing, everything will be given. So like three information is there, which gives you chases information. If you want to look on information on the chases. So these three are normally very important. These minus T, see, you can look at the type, see, DMI type. Type 1, see, type 3, that is the type what we are going to give you. Okay? So DMI type 4, so type is more of processor information, see, lot of processor. So these four are basically much important. So you can write about this. The rest of things are memory connection information. Maybe 5 is also. Address is like more of detailed information about it. You need that part. Okay. So what you can do is that you can issue this command DMI decode space minus T. So 0 to 4 or 5 or 6. But depends upon it will be like DMI decode will be, I think it is still 128 or something is there. Depends upon your hardware, what all the information are stored there. So in some way there less hardware is there, you really have less information. Correct. So what T0123 is very important. Specifically, if you're looking processor information you can get it from OS also, but more specific hardware like which slot and all those things you will need to get into this hardware. Okay. So Srisha, we will stop here. I'm actually disconnecting this meeting and I will start the meeting again after we come back after a break. So now it is 14:13. So we will start by now it is like 4:13. When will be there? 4:30?
Yeah.
So we'll be back by 4:30. Okay.
That's fine. Yeah. All right. Yeah.